Hello and welcome to the episode 43 of What a Fab Day. I am your host, Simon Mas. Today, we will cover an audition, a double feature at the Carnegie Hall, and a recording session, among other things. On the 12th of October 1961, the Beatles, with Pete Best on drums, played the Casbah Coffee Club in Liverpool. As you will recall, the Casbah was in the cellar of the Best home, and it was operated by Pete's mother, Mona. In 1962, as a result of manager Brian Epstein's completion of an application for an audition by Variety Department at BBC's Manchester headquarters, as covered in episode 10 of What a Fab Day, the Beatles were called to have their shot at fame. Epstein's idea was that the audition could secure performances in radio shows, perhaps on a national level, granting the band an immediate recognition that would have made a breeze getting bookings outside Liverpool and in more prestigious venues. And so, the lads travelled to the broadcasting house in Manchester today. The band, still featuring Pete Best on drums, performed four songs, Like Dreamers Do, Till There Was You, Memphis, Tennessee, and Hello, Little Girl. Two originals and two covers, with Paul on lead vocals for the first two songs and John for the second pair. The audition took place in front of Peter Pilbeam, producer of teen radio programs recorded in Northwest England, but broadcast nationally. Pilbeam's notes on the audition were scribbled on the back of the application presented by Brian Epstein on the previous 10th of January. A no for Paul singing, and a yes for John. In addition, Pilbeam found the Beatles to be an unusual group, not as rocky as most, more C&W, country and western, with a tendency to play music. In the end, the Beatles did pass the audition and were booked in a slot in a radio program called Teenager's Turn to be recorded on the following 7th of March. Moving on to 1963, we find the Beatles performing at the Astoria Ballroom in Oldham. John Lennon was still suffering from a heavy cold and was unable to sing after destroying his voice to sing Twist and Shout on the previous day, and so his singing duties were divided between Paul McCartney and George Harrison. The band got by, with the screaming of the fans camouflaging any imperfection due to the impromptu solution. Two events worth our attention happened on the 12th of February 1964. In United Kingdom, the ITV network broadcast Yeah, 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 the Beatles in New York from 10:25 to 11:05 p.m. It was a documentary assemblage of the footage that the Maysles brothers had sent over to Britain, featuring the events so far. If you have no idea who the Maysles brothers are, please refer to episode 38 of What a Fab Day. In the United States, instead, the Beatles returned to New York, New York. The train journey from Washington, D.C. took 2 hours, but the limousine trip from Pennsylvania Station to the Plaza Hotel was simply impossible to complete. The limo was surrounded by an estimated 10,000 fans, and the Beatles had to go back to the station and get into taxis to reach their destination incognito, only to be smuggled into the premises through the kitchens when they found out another crowd was waiting for them outside the plaza. The business of the day was giving 2 34-minute performances at the Carnegie Hall at 7:45 p.m. and at 11:15 p.m. Both houses were full, with 2,900 people in attendance. The demand for tickets had been so high that some of the seating was allocated on the stage itself, on the left, on the right, and behind the band. To ensure everyone's safety, the city employed 362 policemen. An initial plan by Capitol Records to record the performance had to be scrapped due to a disagreement with the American Federation of Musicians, the US Musicians Union. Perhaps it was for the better. The concerts did not satisfy the Beatles, as the acoustic of the Carnegie Hall was not conducive to a rock and roll show, the people on the stage didn't allow the band to perform at ease, and because the now usual mad carousel of VIPs of all kinds backstage made them feel again like animals in a circus. Perhaps it was for these reasons that Brian Epstein forestalled an offer for a further concert at the Madison Square Garden for $25,000 plus a charity donation of $5,000, respectively $208,000 and $41,500 in 2020 money. During the night, the Beatles went out at 1:30 a.m. for the Headliner Club and the Improvisation Coffee House in Greenwich Village. At least, they managed to see a bit of the city outside their cages. Talking about clubbing, John Lennon and Ringo Starr visited the Scotch of St. James nightclub on this evening in 1966. Let's conclude this episode with yet another session for Sentimental Journey in 1970. Between 7 and 9 p.m. today, arranger Les Reed personally conducted the 31-piece orchestra, augmented with 9 singers, recording the band for Let the Rest of the World Go By at the EMI Studios. Following the 11 orchestral takes, between 9 p.m. and 1:30 a.m., Ringo's vocal part was overdubbed and the song was mixed in stereo. This concludes today's episode. Please remember visiting www.simonmas.com/support if you'd like to know ways in which you can help me out putting on the net the best material I can. One of these ways is doing your Beatles-related shopping via the Amazon affiliate links that you will find in the bibliography page of the podcast, linked in the episode description. For the moment, I wish you a good day and a fab continuation. Simon Mas, music you love.